So I'm very pleased to be able to introduce today's speaker in the inaugural Research and Graduate Studies Lecture Series. Claire Bradford has just recently arrived in Canada and at the University of Winnipeg to take up her post as the first ever International Visiting Trudeau Fellow. Yes, we're all very pleased. So she'll be located in the Centre for Research in Young People's Texts and Cultures. If you are looking for her office, that's where it is. She's already on GroupWise under cl.bradford@uwinnipeg.ca, so easily reachable. And her phone number is there too, which I cannot remember offhand. She'll also be teaching for the Department of English in the Cultural Studies MA program this spring, and we're very pleased to know that our students will also have access to her scholarship in that way. Claire has published more than 60 articles over her career, and she's the author or co-author of 5 books in the field of children's literary studies, including in 2001, Reading Race, Aboriginality in Australian Children's Literature, which won the International Children's Literature Association Prize for Best Book in the Field that year. She has many ties to the University of Winnipeg, and we hope she will have more by the time she leaves, one of the most important of which was her collaboration with a number of us working in the field on the Home Project, where we were investigating discourses of home in Canadian children's literature. She produced an article or a chapter for that collection entitled The Homely Imaginary Fantasies of Nationhood in Australian and Canadian Texts, which I would recommend to all of you. So today, Claire is speaking to us about interested fictions, what children's literature can tell us. Please help me welcome Claire to the University of Winnipeg.
Thank you very much, Mavis, and thank you all for your warm welcome. It's a great privilege to be here. It was a total surprise to me when I got the email from Mavis Reimer that we have to talk. And I thought, talk about what? And then I discovered about the Trudeau Fellowships, which was an amazing, amazing discovery. In fact, the following day when I woke up, I had to go to the email to see if I dreamed it. And it is a great privilege to be here, particularly at University of Winnipeg, which has always been a shining light in research and children's literature with the illustrious Kerry Nodelman. And Mavis and all the other people who have been working in this field and making a name for University of Winnipeg in this field. Children's literature research is a new and growing field. It's really developed since the 1960s and 70s. It began in departments of education and librarianship for obvious reasons and soon moved into literature and language departments. And children's literature specialists are located all over the place, really, in terms of departments and disciplinary areas. It's highly interdisciplinary in its approach, taking in literary studies, cultural studies, and it's informed by a variety of theoretical perspectives, including sociology, eco-criticism, post-colonial studies, new historicism, and so on. Humans have always, of course, told stories, and they've always been stories intended particularly for the young, to teach them, to instruct them, to induct them into the culture, to entertain them, often or almost always at the same time. The contemporary approach to children's literature is to avoid didacticism. We think of didactic texts as being a bad thing, boring and tedious. However, this is a fashion. Fashions in writing come and go. Didacticism was considered to be a worthy kind of approach, best approach, in the medieval period, for example. With Romanticism, it began to go out of fashion, came back in Victorian times, and is now out of fashion again. However, the most compelling interest to me is not whether children's literature is didactic or not, but what children's texts say about the politics and the values of their times and places. Further, texts for children always tell us how children are envisaged in particular cultures, how they're spoken to, spoken about, how they are positioned as readers. So an important aspect of children's literature research involves considering the extent to which children's texts encourage children to question, compare, and resist as active and involved readers. Because books always imply their audiences through what they assume, the knowledge, the values, and the beliefs that they treat as normal. Children's texts have always had a social and cultural purpose. They're produced by adults for children, and they form an integral part of pedagogy, and are, of course, part of the processes of socialisation. The very terms children's literature and texts for young people define the literature in relation to its audience in a way that other literatures are not so defined. Perhaps what defines the field of research in children's literature more than anything else is its consciousness of the audiences to which it addresses itself, both in relation to writing and in relation to critical work on children's texts. Those of us who work in children's literature are often very motivated by a sense of the power of textuality and its influence on children. If you've introduced picture books to babies and young children, you will know how significant these experiences are, especially when you're reading the same book for the 20th time and you'd really rather read something else, but the small child you're reading to wants to have that book. It's always a mysterious thing to me how children want the same book over and over and over, and then quite suddenly they don't want it anymore. And there's something going on there that I think that where the child masters or gets hold of or takes in what that book is telling them, is showing them, and then after that's all done, wants to move on to another book. It is a very, very mysterious process, especially in 2 and 3 year old children. So these experiences of early reading are extremely significant, both because of the books themselves and the pleasures that they afford, and because the mediation of books is so intensely social, centred on relations between adults and children. Walter Benjamin gives an especially telling description of the power of reading in the Berlin Chronicle, where he reflects on his childhood in Berlin at the turn of the 20th century. And this is what he says. "What my first books were to me. To remember this, I should first have to forget all other knowledge of books. It is certain that all I know of them today rests on the readiness with which I then opened myself to books. But whereas now content, theme, and subject matter are extraneous to the book, earlier they were solely and entirely in it, being no more external or independent of it than are today the number of its pages or its paper. The world that revealed itself in the book and the book itself were never at any price to be divided. You did not read books through. You dwelt, abided between their lines, and reopening them after an interval, surprised yourself at the spot where you had halted. If you, like me, and you've been a nerdy girl and passionate reader, or a nerdy boy and a passionate reader, you will understand what he's talking about there. You did not read books through, you dwelt, abided between their lines." Benjamin captures perfectly the intensity with which children experience texts. Of course, he's referring to books, but similar effects and affects apply to the other forms of textuality in which children's literature studies is interested. Picture books, films, video games, for example. To grasp what children's books propose about values, politics, and social practices is to see what they envisage as desirable possibilities for the world. As I've said, children's texts also tell us about how children are constructed over time and place, and how childhood is envisaged. The historian of childhood, Hugh Cunningham, says this in his study of children and childhood in Western society since 1500. "The root cause of much present concern and angst about childhood is that a public discourse which argues that children are persons with rights to a degree of autonomy is at odds with the remnants of the romantic view that the right of the child is to be a child. The implication of the first is a fusing of the worlds of the adult and the child, and of the second, the maintenance of the separation. Romantic view of childhood in Western cultures as the best part of life has its foundations in the 17th century in the writings of Locke and Rousseau, and was popularised by Wordsworth. The idea that children exist in a separate sphere from adults is persistent in political and popular discourse. But over the last century, this idea has been undermined by cultural shifts in the way children are regarded, demonstrated in the transformation of children into consumers, the increasing focus on the rights of children and on their evolving capacities encapsulated in the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child, and changes over the last few decades in the way the law deals with children in both criminal and family courts. So what I'm going to do today is very, very quickly take three case studies, three examples of children's texts, and to look at them in terms of what children's books are interested in. The impossibility in the 21st century of maintaining the fiction of childhood as a garden of delight was made starkly clear on September the 11th, 2001. The global reach of mass media and its presence in spaces occupied by children meant that children could not be shielded from images of the planes, the towers, the tumbling bodies. One of the most common topics in media commentaries in the days after September the 11th was how to mediate those events to children. What to say, how much to say, when to say it, and of course anxiety over long-term effects. Almost immediately after 9/11, children's books began to emerge, focusing on the events of this day. By 2005, over 50 such books had been published. One early 9/11 book, published at the beginning of the following year, is Nancy Carlson's There's a Big, Beautiful World Out There. In this book, the child character at the centre of the narrative experiences a pervasive fear. This is the text. There's a lot to be scared of, that's for sure. There's that mean-looking dog and booming thunderstorms. There are roller coasters and scary stories in the news. There's a lot to be scared of, like getting up in front of a whole bunch of people and spiders and other creepy crawly things. There are clowns, spooky shadows in your room, and people who look different from you. All this scary stuff can make you want to hide under your covers and never come out. The antidote to fear is to throw off the covers, because if you hide under your covers, you'll miss your mother saying everything is going to be all right, and you might never know how great you sound singing a solo, and just think of all the new friends you'll never meet. In his essay, The Spirit of Terrorism, Jean Baudrillard remarks that the repression of terrorism spirals around as unpredictably as the terrorist act itself. The most obvious form of repression in There's a Big Beautiful World is the absence of any reference to why the child is afraid, although the book was published early in 2002 and bears the postscript. This book was written on September the 12th, 2001. Among the 9/11 books, a refusal to name is quite common. For instance, another early publication on that day, A Book of Hope for Children, begins, "The world is very big and really round and pretty peaceful," and then proceeds to describe how the world changed forever. One day a terrible thing happened. The world, which had been blue and green and bright and very big and really round and pretty peaceful, got badly hurt. Many people were injured, many other people died, and everyone was sad. In these books, the conflation of the world of America is also a very common feature. To return to There's a Big Beautiful World Out There. As in many 9/11 books, the narrative normalizes fear as the usual default way of being in the world. The second person address, "If you hide under your covers," positions the reader as the audience of a narrator who knows what the child thinks and feels and what she needs to do in order to cope with her fear. And the narrative begins as a statement of fact. There's a lot to be scared of, that's for sure. The litany of things to be frightened of proceeds from dogs, thunderstorms, roller coasters, scary stories, insects, clowns and shadows to people who look different from you, setting up cultural and ethnic difference as the alarming climax of these occasions of fear. A problem with books produced with an eye to the bibliotherapy market, like this one, is their glibness, in that in the space of the 32 pages of the picture book, they are locked into narratives of resolution. The trajectory from "there's a lot to be scared of, that's for sure, people who look different from you" to the happy campers that you see at the end of the book, who are the same ones that we saw earlier, is unmediated by represented actions or events involving shifts in affectivity or cognition, and presents a fantasy of nationhood which functions as a happily ever after closure. The final words of the book, "and just think of all the new friends you'll never meet," enforce the sense that this vision of interracial and cross-cultural harmony is to be attained only if the child can overcome fear. So fear is there, right at the centre of the narrative. Earlier I discussed the differences between the romantic view of the child who is asked only to be a child and the cultural shifts which have rendered unstable older lines of demarcation between child and adult. Many of the 9/11 books revert to a ghettoisation of children through strategies of control, sentimentality and oversimplification. They conform to what Baudrillard says about the reversibility that is terrorism's true victory, and which is manifested by a slump in the value system and the whole ideology of freedom, of free circulation, on which the Western world prided itself. Okay, moving away from 9/11, the next kind of case study that I'm going to look at is a relatively early Australian work. Minnie Rowe's little book, Gully Folk, from 1919. A great deal of my research over the last 15 years has focused on colonial and post-colonial texts, and especially on what these texts reveal about cultural values as they manifest in representations of indigeneity and relations between Indigenous and non-Indigenous peoples. There are many correspondences across Australian and Canadian books, one of which involves the use of fantasy in colonial texts. When European genres and traditions of fantasy were introduced into colonial landscapes, they typically pointed to a sense of dislocation between the environment and the imported language and visual imagery now used to describe it, a gap between the experienced place and the descriptions of the language and the visual imagery provided. Minnie Rowe's Gully Folk is one of many early Australian fantasies in which fairies are introduced into Australian settings. In this text, two children, Betty and Dick, exploring in the bush near their homes, discuss Billy Whiskers, an old blackfellow, as the text describes him, whose grandfather, Wangawara, taught him magic words which, when uttered, would summon forth fairies to protect his people. As Dick utters the name Wangawara, a tiny fur-covered fairy called Wongo leaps out of the bush, demanding to know what Dick has done with Wangawara. A crowd of fairies then materialise, led by a stern-faced princess. They gather around the two children, pointing at them, scowling, shaking their fists, and singing this song. I'll leave you to read that. And it goes on, I'm afraid. There are many uncomfortable encounters between children and Indigenous characters in colonial adventure narratives in Australia and Canada, involving young settlers uneasily aware of the fact that their occupation of the land is contingent upon the dispossession of Indigenous peoples. The encounter in Gully Folk between the two children and the fairies is, I think, even more fraught than these encounters, partly because it so starkly represents the clearing out, what the term used in Australia of clearing out of Indigenous nations from the landscape, but also because reading this episode now evokes the long history of the stolen generations in Australia. Aboriginal children taken from their families to be de-Aboriginalised. The bush, formerly the children's playground, is now an unhomely place to Betty and Dick. Their very identities as the descendants of pioneers crumble and collapse. Betty's grandfather was a gold miner and Dick's a squatter, and it seems that their implication in the disappearance of the black children loads Betty and Dick with a sense of guilty complicity. The dilemma of colonial children's literature is that it seeks to position non-Indigenous readers as young Australians at home in their world, while simultaneously managing the colonial past and its sorry stories of violence and dispossession. In Gully Folk, Minnie Rowe turns to fairies to solve this problem of history. The princess explains to Dick and Betty that fairies occupied Australia before Aboriginal people arrived and taught black people bushcraft. Even corroborees were based on the Aborigines' observation of fairy dances. When the full moon looked down into the gullies, they would come and watch us at our dances, some of which they would copy at any time of rejoicing and call it a corroboree. However, the princess says, we are to blame for not teaching black people more quickly. While the fairies in other lands were urging their people on as quickly as possible, we were content for ours to remain like little children. So the moment of unhomeliness passes and the doctrine of social Darwinism is reasserted. Betty begs the princess to forgive the white men and love the white children as you do the black pickaninnies, whereupon the fairies sing a song which reverses their earlier lament. It's extraordinary, isn't it? If we can't have black pickaninnies, then white are the next best thing. As the song ended on a high, glad note that made the childish hearts leap for joy, there came a blinding flash of lightning followed by an awful, deafening roar that sent the children reeling into each other's arms. When the dreadful moment passed and they could open their eyes again, there was not a sign of a fairy left. If the fickleness of the fairies of Gully Folk sounds a warning about how long the white pickaninnies will remain the next best thing, the text provides enough cues to reassure its readers that they are protected by their superior capacity to move beyond childhood and into an imagined adulthood, inserted into the landscape as the country's new natives. The fairies of Gully Folk intervene in history through their influence on children, that is, by advocating an ameliorist and Eurocentric view of history as progress. Okay, moving on to the third little case study that I'm doing. And this is about medievalisms in children's texts. One of my more recent obsessions, it's an old obsession really, because I started my academic, my scholarly life as a medievalist, which brings together my background and my interest in contemporary children's literature, is how the medieval era is used in children's texts. The medieval is, of course, everywhere. Picture books, historical novels, reworkings of Arthurian narratives, Disney animations, video games located in medieval settings, and much, much more. My interest in medievalisms in children's literature is not concerned with how authentic they are, since I think investigations of this kind mostly lead to a dead end. Rather, I'm interested in what medievalisms for children teach us about the power of fantasy to make history. Texts which draw on medieval settings, characters and tropes construct imaginaries, advocate values and offer pleasures which may have very little to do with a real Middle Ages, but which have more to say about the present and projection of the future. The medieval scholar J.J. Cohen calls for an examination of the epistemological colonisations of time, specifically the huge stretch of time around 1,000 years now known as the Middle Ages, now that we've stopped talking about the Dark Ages, which is generally treated as the other to modernity, a space of empty waiting and virtual death until the reawakening of the West to its proper nature and purpose. Here I'm intending to look very briefly at a bundle of books for younger readers set in medieval times. They're a bit of a mixture. Colin McNaughton's King None the Wiser, he's a British author-illustrator, Barbara Shook Hazen and Tony Ross's The Knight Who Was Afraid of the Dark, Tony Ross is from the UK, and Barbara Shook Hazen is an American writer. Tony Davis and Gregory Rogers' short novel, Roland Wright, Future Night, they're an Australian duo. And Libby Gleason and Armin Greta's Great Bear. The last one is another Australian book. Armin Greta migrated to Australia from Switzerland. Medievalisms for younger children involve fairy tale retellings, reversions, parodies of fairy tales, narratives involving elements which are recognisably medieval but transposed into more or less contemporary settings, such as texts involving fairies, castles, witches, magic, and so on, and narratives where protagonists are located in a medieval world. Many texts in this last category treat the medieval as a generic Western setting, in which elements such as castles, knights, monsters, villages, and fair maidens combine to produce a universalised medievalist habitus. Often they adopt a humorous and semi-parodic tone. King None the Wiser, for instance, follows the progress of a bookish king who is forced into adventures because his people want a king who can fight dragons and slay giants. King Nun is oblivious to the giant, the enchanted forest, and the dragon he encounters, and is astonished to find on his return that he has become a hero to his people. A similar pattern obtains in The Night He Was Afraid of the Dark, in which Sir Fred conquers his fear of the dark for the sake of Lady Gwendolyn, discovering that she is as afraid of the fireflies an electric eel as he is of the dark. The ideologies of these narratives are broadly in line with progressive contemporary values. For instance, that peaceful pursuits are preferable to violence, and that it is not unmanly for a male to acknowledge his fears. Davis and Rogers, Roland Wright, Future Night, involves a storyline in which Roland, the armourer's son, must compete with his brother Shelby to see which of them will be trained as a page in the king's household. While their father tests them in the pursuits of making armour, sword fighting, and archery, the real test concerns who of the two is the more fair, generous, and chivalrous. The worlds of these books are represented as uncomplicated, populated by characters like King Nun and Sir Fred, who are presented as likeable but dim. In King Nun, a credulous citizenry believes everything they hear, and in The Night He Was Afraid of the Dark, Sir Fred's rival for Gwendolyn's hand is the incompetent and stupid Melvin the Mift. The humour of all three books relies on a gentle mockery of chivalric practices and values. On one hand, these are depicted as quaint and fusty, but on the other, they are seen to offer models of behaviour which transcend temporality. In Roland Wright, Future Night, Roland asks Sir Gallowood for advice. He says, "I need to know how to bash and crash and slab and dice and slice and pound, and I need to know how to smite people." Sir Gallowood, however, offers a classic articulation of liberal humanism. The object of a contest is not to beat your opponent. The object is to be true to yourself. To be medieval in these books is then to be childlike, in accordance with the long-held view of the Middle Ages as the childhood and adolescence of Western modernity. But the medieval is also desirable, since it's represented as a purer, more wholesome time, predating the complexities of modern life. The books that I've pointed to so far represent medieval life as all vitality and energy, populated by childlike protagonists, and filled with fun, joking, and laughter. Another version of the medieval pertains to a late 20th and 21st century orientation, which defines the word medieval as antiquated, unenlightened, feudal, even barbaric, especially when applied to Islamic cultures and practices. Armin Greta and Libby Gleason's The Great Bear has most in common with the latter form of medievalism. It tells the story of Ursa Major, the great bear constellation of the Northern Hemisphere, but this is also the story of a circus bear who lives in a medieval world where she's caged by day and made to dance at night by the light of torches in town squares where acrobats and tumblers, trapeze artists and clowns performed for the crowd. When she refuses to dance, she's tormented with sticks and stones until she breaks free from her chains and climbs a flagpole in the town square. From here, she launches herself into the night sky to become Ursa Major. The medievalism of the Great Bear is defined by Greta's representations of the faces of the crowd, viewed as if from the perspective of the bear in this particular illustration. These faces are generic, eyes set wide apart, mouths gloating in anticipation of the bear's degradation, huddled together, their bodies overlapping and uniformly clothed in greys and browns, they're presented as a mass rather than as individuals. From the moment the bear escapes, the wordless illustrations focus on her actions as she climbs the flagpole and leaps into the sky. The end paper is showing a map of the constellations of the Northern Hemisphere with the Great Bear in their place. When this book was published, much of the discussion it attracted revolved around the question of whether it represented an act of suicide, despite the fact that the final end papers direct readers toward the symbolism of the constellations and the mythologies which cluster around them. To me, though, the narrative of the Great Bear has more to do with the abjection of the medieval and its definition as a period of barbarism and brutality. The medieval past is used to signify a time in which cruelty to animals was a norm, and to distinguish this time from an implied present, the time of the book's readers, in which humans no longer treat animals in this way. The narrative could, after all, have been located in a contemporary setting where bears continue to be ill-treated, as they are in many parts of the world, since the verbal text includes no signifiers which connected either to time or to place. But rather than identifying a contemporary setting as barbaric, it conducts what Cohen refers to as a colonization of time, producing the medieval past as an object of knowledge and reducing it to a single mode of representation. So the texts I've touched on today are texts which are deeply interested in their audiences. They advocate values and propose ways of being. Children's literature is frequently conservative, valuing social cohesion and stability. Yet it is open to various visions of the good society. Far from being the immature, simple sister to mainstream literature, children's literature comprises a complex body of texts, inviting a complex intersection of scholarly approaches. Thank you very much.
Questions?
Anyone has questions or comments?
I see Jennifer there.
Jennifer.
As you were talking about medievalism, I kept thinking of Harry Potter. Mm-hmm. I didn't know if there's any comment you would have.
Heaps and heaps, of course, of images and tropes and references in Harry Potter, especially all the magic. However, it's interesting in the Harry Potter books, I think, how that kind of field of textuality and of references is overlaid in the school story, the 19th century school story. I find the Harry Potter books deeply conservative, really, in the way that they speak to children. And the medieval tropes and images are part of the sort of the effect of the books without really, I think, changing much of the conservatism of the books as a whole. However, I must admit that I've only read the first Harry Potter book because I found it so tedious that I couldn't force myself. So I'm far from an expert on Harry Potter. Deborah.
Yeah, are there, in terms of, you have, what was it? I can't remember. It was a gorgeous phrasing.
kind of dull but well-meaning, that sort of
yeah.
Mayo hero in the medievalist text you're working with. What about females?
Yeah.
Any sort of troublesome, bubbly, unsettling, unstill females in this, or are they all just sort of troped in the same
way? In this particular body of texts, I think adults are generally pretty childlike and silly. You know, it's a sort of homogenized Middle Ages.
Sounds like what you could buy at 7-Eleven.
Yeah. To get more interesting representations of female characters, I guess you'd need to go to books for slightly older children and perhaps historical novels. And, of course, in all the fantasy, all the Arthurian fantasy, which is so abundant. I think one of the things that these medievalist texts do, you know, like The King Nun, by setting up an adult protagonist who's really, really stupid and dim, this places the child reader, of course, in a position of great power and the delight of knowing what the character doesn't know is part of the fun of the book. Aren't I clever? You know, the child is looking at this very dim adult. It's a delightful experience, especially if you're small and not very powerful yourself.
Are there such books that trouble the sort of illusory division between the medieval and the early modern and the modern?
There haven't been all that many kind of historiographic metafictions in the field of children's literature. Perry would know about this more than I do, probably. One that I can think of, one series, is an Australian one, the Pagan books, Pagan's Crusade, and the whole series that came out about the character of Pagan. And in the series, Catherine Jenks mixes and melds contemporary and medieval idioms and ideas. For example, Pagan, who's the young boy who's taken up as a squire and becomes a knight and so on, has a phrase that he keeps on saying, which is "Christ in the cream cheese sauce." Now, of course, that's not medieval, and what it draws attention to is the impossibility of really returning to the medieval, and also the gaps and the schisms between the representation and the time in which the story is set. So I think that's a sort of self-conscious and playful approach to representations of medievalism, which draws attention to the fictionality of the texts and the impossibility of going back unproblematically to the medieval period. There aren't, however, a lot of books like that. Most of the historical books that I've seen set in medieval settings, present the medieval setting as a slice of life as it was. And in fact, most of the critical attention to medievalisms has been in terms of how authentic they are, you know, the extent to which they really represent how things were in the Middle Ages, as they would really, really know.
Is it peculiar to studies of children's books? Is that a kind of general trend in the scholarship? Because for non-children's books, I find that it's much more sophisticated.
Much more, yes. This is why I'm getting into this medievalism jag, because it is quite a neglected area in children's literature research and criticism. Whereas when I read in the field of medievalism studies, as you say, much more consciousness of the amazing diversity and complexity of the medieval world and relationships between medieval and modern are treated in a much more interesting way. So, yeah. I think it's partly related to the fact that the field of children's literature research is quite young and takes a long time to take up new ways of reading texts. And I think the medieval links between medievalism studies and children's literature haven't really started to emerge yet.
Yeah. Uh, well, dominate, but just to say, as I'm sure you know, medievalism itself is about as old as the field as children's literature, and so part of what you're saying, and Canadian studies, part of what you're saying is exacerbated, I think, by the newness of medievalism and the way it has had to, as it were, win its spurs in face of medievalists who study real medieval literature rather than going into the side waters of medievalism.
That's exactly right. I was reading an article by Tom Prendergast and Stephanie Trigg, and they were talking about medieval studies and how they're often told that students taking up medieval studies are not bright enough to do real medievalism. They're reading, they're looking at video games and representations of medievalism because they're just not bright enough to read Chaucer. And those of us who work in children's literature have exactly the same kinds of things said to us, that children, that our students who read children's texts are reading the Harry Potters and children's texts because they're just not bright enough to read texts for adults. So, you know, it's, the field of medievalism studies is similarly kind of marginalised and slightly outside the real medieval studies in a way that children's literature is quite often marginalised and outside real literature. Which is what we're trying to address, you know, working in the field of children's literature.
On behalf of the Research and Graduate Studies Office and everyone here, I'd like to thank you so much for this today. I know I'm going to be reading Liam's story tonight, looking at it differently for sure. And I'd like to give you this. It's our token of appreciation for the talk. And once again, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And thank you all for coming. I know it's a busy time, a busy time of the